73 to worship. Let's stand now.
Live funeral coverage of Kerry Donley's funeral. Blessed Sacrament.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Reading from the Book of Wisdom. The just man, though he die early, shall be at rest. For the age that is honorable comes not with the passing of time, nor can it be measured in terms of years. Rather, understanding is the holy ground for men, and an unsullied life, the attainment of old age. He who pleased God was loved. He who lived among sinners was transported. Snatched away, lest wickedness pervert his mind or deceive the guile of his soul. For the witchery of paltry things obscure what is right, and the whirl of desire transforms the innocent mind. Having become perfect in a short while, he reached the fullness of a long career. For his soul was pleasing to the Lord. Therefore he sped him out of the midst of wickedness. But the people saw and did not understand, nor did they take this into account. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Mm-hmm.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but handed him over for all of us. He will not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Jesus Christ who died, rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine? Or nakedness or peril or the sword? No. In all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels or principalities, nor present things nor future things, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor any of the creatures will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
His presence as
faith will be called home to the Lord to give an accounting of how we have lived our life. And during the course of our lives, we experience the deaths of people we love, people we care about, people who are important to us. So it's only natural that we grieve and mourn. And that's a good and healthy thing that we do. But this is our way of coping with the reality of death, with our powerlessness in the face of it. So we grieve and we mourn for ourselves and we think, wow, this man was so young, so vital. Why would God take him so soon? But we know that God makes no mistakes. And for some reason known in the mind and heart of God, it was time for Kerry to be called home to the Lord. So again, we grieve because our lives are so changed. A face that we no longer see, a voice that we no longer hear. So our lives are changed, they're different. But as people of faith, as sons and daughters of the risen Lord, you and I also know that today is a day to rejoice, to give thanks to God, for this man that you knew and loved has been called home to the Lord for the very purpose for which he was made. Kerry was taught that God made him to know him, to love him, and to serve him in this life, so as to be happy with him in the eternal life to come. And we know that he did that, and he did it well. He knew, loved, and served God by loving and serving his family, his friends, the community in which he lived. So that's why with great confidence we can carry back to God today, knowing that he has been that good and faithful servant. Kerry was born in Elk Point, South Dakota, a little 2,000 people prairie town, not far from the Missouri River, on the Nebraska border. One of the five children of Owen and Carol Donley. And at the very beginning of his life, his mom and dad gave him the greatest gift the parents can give their children. They brought Kerry to St. Joseph's Church. And there he was born again in water and the Spirit. He was claimed for Christ, and Kerry would belong faithfully to the Lord throughout his journey. He began a relationship with the Lord, a relationship that culminated when he received that last blessing of the church in his home, the day God took him from us. As a little boy, his family moved here to Alexandria in 1963. He attended Blessed Sacrament School under the watchful care of the Sisters of the Holy Cross. In 1964, in our parish church, the old church, a block away, he made his first Holy Communion. In 1966, he received the sacrament of confirmation, in which he pledged to follow Christ as an adult, as a full-fledged member of the church. And on that day, he was given an opportunity to choose another saint's name. And Kerry chose the name James. Today is the Feast of St. James. So we think about this encounter that the two of them are going to have now in the life of heaven. But it was here that he was formed in his faith. And then he went on to Bishop Ireland High School. There under the watchful care of the oblates of St. Francis de Sales. And then to Marquette with the Jesuits there helping to form him to take his rightful role in society, to serve God, to serve the church, to serve his family, to serve his brothers and sisters in the world. We know that his career was in banking, and it was during a summer banking job that he met Eva Jane Chapman, and the two of them fell in love, and they wanted to have that love made sacred and holy. On October 20th, 1979, here in Blessed Sacrament Church, with Father Eugene Leonard officiating, they entered into a sacrament of love, the sacrament of marriage. And for 42 years, Eva, you have lived out that bond. Jesus tells us that in marriage, two people join together to become of one mind and one heart. And we know that you and Kerry did that, and you did it so beautifully. this incredible loss and change in your life. But again, thank you for this beautiful witness of marriage that you've given to your daughters, your sons-in-laws, your grandchildren, to all of us. We know how special it is to find someone to share our life with, and you have done it so beautifully in this holy bond. We know that one of the fruits of marriage is the birth of children. When we look at Kristen, Caitlin, Colleen, Kara, and Kelsey, we see this living witness of your mom and dad's love for each other. And your dad lives on in you in such a very special way. Again, dad is someone who provides for us, who protects us, who guides us, who maybe at times chastises us, who spoils us, who worries about us, but most especially, who loves us. And we know that your dad loved his five girls so much, and he found such joy in all of you. The same thing with his sons-in-laws and his five precious grandchildren. How special you are to him. And all of you have these memories that you're going to cherish and relive. But again, it's a change, and it hurts. God understands, and your dad understands as well. And he wants you to continue on, to continue to be who you are, to do your part in this world. For each and every one of us, we know, has a role to play. Kerry was so much a part of this community of Alexandria, reaching out in various ways to help those who were in need, serving as vice mayor and as mayor. So we had always this realization that we are to share our gifts and our talents, that we are not for them, that we are to be that light that shines forth for others to see and profit by. So we are grateful to Kerry and for this life of service. We heard today in the gospel, rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven will be great. Jesus, in giving us the Beatitudes, was letting us know that it's not always going to be easy to live out our faith in this world, but with God's grace, everything is possible. And Kerry lived his faith each and every Sunday. He and Eva would be right over there at the 9 o'clock Mass, part and parcel, and it's going to seem so different without him there. But it was here that he came to be nourished in his faith. It was here that he came to get the strength that he needed to be of service to this community. It's here that his children and grandchildren come to celebrate the sacraments as well. So again, we see a man who had his priorities in order. God, family, and other people. So we give him back to God today, knowing that he has enriched the lives of so many people. And the greatest tribute that we can pay him is, of course, to show that we are better people because we knew and shared in his life. So if we can be more faithful to God, more loving to our family and friends, more open to serving one another because of Kerry's example, then we have paid him the greatest tribute. We show that not only are we better people for knowing him, but the world is a better place for us all, and the kingdom of God is more reality. So we remember all that was good and special about this man, and we make that part of us. But for now, we pray for Kerry. We pray that he will have the eternal rest that he believed in, and we ask that he will pray for us as well, that we too might be faithful, so that like him, our reward will be great. We look forward to that day when we see him again. And that's one of the great consolations of our faith, is death is not the end, it's just a change. But until then, we pray for him. We ask him to pray for us, and we look forward to seeing him in glory. But for now, we entrust him to God, the God who created him out of love, the God who loved him during his journey here on earth, and the God who will love him now for all eternity. Eternal rest grant to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. May his soul and all the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother Kerry, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of our brother Kerry, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in hope of rising again, that they may see God's face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love with the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated now as our gifts are brought forward. Blessed resurrection is gone, but though saddened by the certainty of dying, might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is change, not end. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
May this
we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever."
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other this sign of peace. sacrament of his body, who, with the journey, mercifully granted, strengthened by it, our brother Kerry may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. At this time, we will now have rites of remembrance from Kerry's son, Caitlin, and from his best friend, David Speck.
Good morning. My name is Caitlin Donley, and I'm Kerry Nico's second oldest daughter. Our family would first like to express our gratitude to everyone in this room for joining us today to celebrate the life of our father, grandfather, and loving husband to our mom. We have been so moved by the outpouring of support over the last 10 days, and take comfort in knowing that Dad's life was rich with such meaningful friendships, both in this room and more could not be with us today. I'm honored that my family has entrusted me with the role of speaking about my dad and sharing about his extraordinary life, particularly his life as a family man. As a friend of Dad's emailed us in the days after his death, no one lived the family first motto better than Dad. As Father Kelly said, the story of our family starts back in the summer of 1975, when Dad was working as a bank teller and Mom was working in the bookkeeping department at the same bank, while both home from college. When a customer would come to the bank to withdraw money, Dad would have to call down to the bookkeeping department to check their account balance, because apparently that's all that was done after the day. While the employees in bookkeeping were locating the proper account, Dad would sing along to whatever song was playing on the radio, doing his best to charm the ladies, including her mom, as they worked. Dad loved to sing, as those who sat near him in church could attest. On family road trips, he could often be found drumming on the steering wheel and using whichever daughter was seated in the front seat as part of his drum set. And though the serenades from his teller's booth didn't land him a record contract, he landed the ultimate prize, our mom. They went on to raise their five daughters in Seminary Valley, calling their house a North Pickett Street home since 1985. And Dad instilled in each of us the values of hard work and service to others, and a love of sports, community, and family. And these were the things Dad lived by. Dad's love of sports ranged from grandkids' soccer to baseball games to Washington Nationals and Caps games. He very well may hold the record for the most TC field hockey games attended. Often in a suit and tie, having come straight from work, explaining to other parents on the sidelines the rules of obstruction and corners. Dad made the drive out to Bloomington, Indiana on many occasions to cheer on daughter Kara and her crew races, sometimes driving through the night after a city council meeting so he could see her race for 7 whole minutes. He followed the Nationals closely, even throughout this rather dismal season, his cell phone often chiming with score alerts from ESPN, and Mom and Dad enjoyed going to many games together each season. Dad knew just about every college mascot, and would often quiz his daughter's potential suitors to see if they would hang. Bonus points if you knew the mascots of Bates and Denson. And perhaps more than anything, Dad looked forward to March Madness each year, and our parents traveled to watch some of the men's tournament on a number of occasions. This past March, in fact, they met up with some of Dad's college buddies at Milwaukee to watch 6 games. Dad appointed himself the commissioner of our family bracket, sending out several daily email updates with the standings and citing each one's stay frosty, which is good advice on a day like today. His love of college basketball dates back to his time as a college student at Marquette, when the men's team won their first and only national championship. Safe to say, Marquette blue and gold represented at least 50% of Dad's wardrobe, and that's a conservative estimate. He was an extremely proud alumnus, and he didn't miss many opportunities to catch Marquette sporting events, be it in person or on TV. He was even known to have gone to a Marquette women's volleyball game when they faced off against Georgetown several years ago. He was the only Marquette fan in the stands. Cheering them on to a win against the Hoyas, and the Marquette Athletics website subsequently featured a picture of the win, and there in the background was Dad, sitting solo in the stands, much to the embarrassment of his daughters. Dad loved Alexandria, and Alexandria loved Dad, or at least most of the voters did. Dad bought Alexandria home since 1963 when his family moved Tamahori our boys to the Potomac Air Playground. For the sight of the Tamahori machine on the base of the Potomac, Pride and Tooth really excited about. While these reminders may be painful in the early days, we take great comfort in knowing we will continue to feel his presence as we go about our daily lives. He always emphasized the importance of giving back to the community in which you lived. And one way to participate in this endeavor is to support local businesses. Colleen, in particular, promises to continue this tough task. Don't worry, Dad, she also promises to check her bank account frequently and save for the future, as the banker in Utah all of us to do. The warmth of this community was perhaps most apparent to us during an earlier trial faced by our family. Kristen's oldest, Jackson, was diagnosed with a brain tumor at the age of 2.5. This was an incredibly difficult time for our family, and Dad took the news particularly hard. But Dad also felt the love of the people in this room as our family was lifted up in prayer and generously supported. Those acts are a testament to the community that we call home. And they're also a testament to my dad and to the time that he gave to the citizens of Alexandria. Our community gave so abundantly because Dad always gave so much of himself. Jackson's grief battle also greatly strengthened Dad's faith and solidified our beliefs in the power of prayer and the existence of miracles. Today, Jackson is healthy and thriving. We'll be starting at Alexander City High School this fall. More than anything, Dad loved his family, and he left no doubt about his love for us because he made sure to tell us each time we saw him. He was our biggest cheerleader. Similarly, there was no doubt about his love for his five grandchildren, Jackson, Mason, Jillian, Graham, and Bennett. And he beamed when he looked at them. Grandpa, as he was known to them, was quick to wrap each grandchild in his arms and ask if they wanted a big hug or a baby hug. And no matter their answer, Grandpa always loved a big hug. And to this, we looked alike. Grandpa was overjoyed to learn that Kelsey is expecting a baby girl later this year. And we will all be sure to love on her the way Grandpa showed us to love with our whole hearts and nothing. I was expecting how Dad loved Mom. Each morning when Mom would join Dad and Brinkley to read the newspaper over their morning coffee, he would remark, "Oh, Brinkley, look at that beautiful woman. Our day just got brighter." They made a great team, and they truly let each other be their best selves. Our mom always told him that he made life fun, and that he did. They both retired in July of last year, and were able to enjoy one glorious year of retirement together. Dad stayed involved in a number of community organizations, including delivering Meals on Wheels, and Mom became a reading buddy at Polk Elementary School. Dad cycled and fished many days, tossing back whatever he caught, but not before snapping a picture to send to grandsons Jack and Mason, co-workers and friends, and to show Mom when he got home. Mom and Dad did many pandemic jigsaw puzzles together, with Dad singing and dancing around the table as they worked, making Mom fall more in love with him each day. Our family recently returned from two fabulous weeks up on Martha's Vineyard, one of our parents' favorite places, and a vacation our family looked forward to each year. Dad exceeded his personal goal of biking over 300 miles during these 2 weeks, recapping his route each day upon his return, often in excruciating detail. But we wouldn't be able to get another turn by turn recap on those rides. We turned right after everything, catching us up on current events, financial advice, career advice, assistance with a flat tire, no matter the distance, and help with math homework. He liked to say, only half joking, that he had completed algebra 6 times, once for himself, once for each of his daughters. We found ourselves wanting to talk to him about so many things in the recent days. Mason wants to talk to him about the Caps' offseason goalie acquisitions. Julie wants to make him laugh one more time, see if he can walk her face as fancy like. Graham wants one more of his big hugs, even though he would have asked for a baby hug. And Bennett wants to go see the baby in the mirror with his grandpa. One of my favorite things about my dad is how he loved out loud. We knew each day that our family was the most important thing in his life, and that we are our parents' greatest legacy. Dad wrote us a note for Father's Day several years ago, encouraging us to use our talents and values to contribute to society, and to live our lives recognizing that the world around us will be better because of us. And for you, Dad, that is exactly what we plan to do. So while we leave here today feeling the enormity of his absence, we also leave here today feeling extraordinarily blessed. Blessed to be a part of the Southern community. blessed to be uplifted by our family and friends, and most of all, blessed to have loved and been loved by such an extraordinary man.
I don't know everyone here, but I think I know most of you. And beyond our grief that brings us together today, we share something in common. No matter how we knew Kerry, what board we served on, what event we all went to, we are all spokes in a big wheel. Kerry was the cog. We counted on him for an answer, solution, a perspective that made things manageable. He was smart, sure. But there are plenty of smart politicians, or at least they think they are. But not everyone can lead and make everyone feel like they were listened to, respected, and validated. I will tell you truthfully that municipal finance is not one of those sexy topics that you might talk about that carries knowledge and skill in the area of municipal finance has served this city long after he left office. There were times in this city when we were confronted with difficult financial circumstances. His guidance led us through that and has lasted to this day. The foundations that he helped to create began small. Patent and trademark office, new school, new firehouse, camera station. I mean, almost everything that you see in this city was a function of the city's ability to afford it. And that was a foundation that Kerry was critically important to. I told him once that he was like our Lem the plumber, only without wrenches or catchy jingle. We always knew we could count on him anytime, any day, when Kristen called me to tell me what happened, all I think I blurted out was, no, this is not the way it's supposed to be. Not very comforting, I know, but my brain could just not comprehend what Kristen was telling me. We had a plan. He was supposed to outlive me and talk in my funeral, not his. Looking around this room, I can see that there are generational differences. How we frame our life events. For some of us, we can remember exactly where we were and what we were doing when we heard that President Kennedy was shot. Most of us over 30 can remember the same thing when we saw 9/11 on television. But what connects every single person in this room is that we remember the day, the time, and the moment when we heard about Kerry. Shock and disbelief doesn't even begin to describe how we felt. I think we'll be feeling that for a long, long time. That's the power of who he was and what he meant to all of us. If Kerry was the cog to our spokes, then his cog was family. He and I talked and texted often, but I don't think a week went by that he was not telling me some exciting news about one of the kids or grandkids. When we were both serving on council at the same time, we talked sometimes about the difficulty of balancing the time, in his case, to be husband, dad to five fathers, and then grandkids added to the mix, mayor, and that crazy part of his life he called working for a living. All those things that he did so well. And you asked him how he managed all this. He had a one-word answer. Evil. If you want to see strength, look no further than right there. It didn't hurt, though, that they had five perfectly behaved daughters. I have that right. I spoke a moment ago about how we all remember. Jack and Mason. Jillian was having a girls' night. I'm not sure exactly what that meant. But Marcia came to the game also just because she loves seeing the boys running around having so much fun. Jack was chasing foul balls, and Mason spent the better part of the game leaning over a fence talking to one of the coaches for the opposing team. We were just cracking up because every time we looked over there, there would be Mason leaning on the fence, and we don't know what he talked about, but they talked for a long time. It was a gorgeous summer night. The temperature in the low 70s, the field was like a green carpet, the hot dogs hot, the ice cream cold. It was pure Americana. Kerry was grandpa at his best, and that's a memory that will stay in my heart forever. Kerry and I first got to know each other about 30 years ago when I was starting my first term on city council, and he was beginning his second. To be precise, we knew of each other. We didn't know each other, but probably had some preconceived opinions based on the different letters after our names, D for him and R at the time for me. We quickly realized, though, that we shared a lot in common about the importance of local government in solving problems and meeting needs, and understood that we might occasionally be opponents, which was not that often actually, but we were never enemies. We knew what our responsibility was, and that, I think, linked us together in so many different respects. I left council after one term because I needed some time to think about my political home. I decided to change parties in 1995 with no plan as to what that would lead to. But shortly after that, Kerry became mayor as a result of the mayor at the time being elected to the state senate. That left a vacancy on the council. I decided to run again in a special election. And with the support from Kerry and friends like Lonnie Rich and the late Michael Jackson and Nelson Green, I was more easily accepted into my new political family and I was elected. Two of the people who really helped with my campaign were Kerry's twin sister, Kelly, and his brother, Scott. Kelly had a pretty good skill set for messaging, and she helped me produce some campaign literature that addressed things I thought I could improve on, the idea being that I just wasn't going to be another voice to lockstep with the rest. It wasn't a hit piece or anything, but Kerry saw it, and he was a little put out. I think his exact comment was, "You know you're talking about the council I'm leading, don't you?" My exact response was, "Kerry, your sister wrote this." His reaction was one of the great Kodak moments. He paused for a moment and then we both started laughing. For the past 3 decades, we wanted to crack each other up. All I had to say was, "Your sister wrote it." Some time ago, I read a short passage in the book. I don't remember the book or the author, but it wasn't one of those collections of great thoughts. It may just be some fiction I was reading, but whatever the source, it was significant enough that I wrote it down, never expecting to use it this way. But it says it captures the spirit of who Kerry was, and our memory of him still does. What matters most is not the things that politics tells us to strive for. What matters most is fulfilling those 4 capacities with which we are born: love, hope, faith, and respect for the truth. When I think about Kerry and those capacities, love, hope, faith, and respect for the truth, that is a cup that does not just run over, it surrounds us and it inspires us. Kerry was often described as transactional, and that was not meant to be a criticism. What that spoke to was fundamentally what made him so effective. He loved local government, but the great thing you could see was a problem, like a solution, and make it happen. And what he loved about Alexandria was that it was big enough to have all the problems of any urban community, but small enough to get your hands around. He lived to solve problems, meet needs, and fill voids, but the strength of his leadership was seeing those problems and needs and voids and not just waiting for them to become obvious. When Jack got sick, Kerry's challenge was to accept the fact that this was something he couldn't fix. There was a lot of prayer, there was a lot of positive energy flowing, there was a lot of gathering of medical information, but he couldn't fix it. And what he did best chairs and talk about pretty much everything, including some good old-fashioned gossip. And thank goodness our meetings were gatherings we never reported. But our focus was usually politics, especially at the national level, interspersed with a lot of comments about a certain person. If you know what I'm thinking about, I think you do. That's as much as we'll go into politics on that level. But over time, some others joined our original group as semi-regular associate members, John Porter, Lonnie Rich, Rob Dunn, and Gene Sterling. We just kept meeting and talking and danced by every Sunday. Like so many other things we talked about, Kerry was the cog. No matter the subject or who went in, there was a sense that this particular matter was not finished until we heard from Kerry. During the week, we all often texted her. All it took was one observation about something notable, and there'd be a flurry of texts back and forth from everyone making comments. If I was home and I didn't have my phone on silent, there'd be a ding, and then ding, 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 and you get the Marcia would hear that and ask me, what was going on? I paused and then she knew, it's the boys, isn't it? It won't ever hurt to say. I'm not sure whether I'm dating myself, but I want to close with some words from Warren Zevon. You'll look that up later. He was a singer, songwriter, lyricist who died about 20 years ago. And it was public knowledge that he was very ill and he was not going to live that much longer. David Letterman was a big fan, and Zevon came on a show, and Letterman asked him whether he's looking at life differently now. He paused, thought for a moment, and then summarized it all in three simple words. Enjoy every sandwich. He went on to say that wasn't his advice as if it was your last one, but a way to think about your life always. Hug your kids, breathe the air, savor friendships, and love every moment. Kerry loved his family. His friends, politics, community service, his faith, bike rides, fishing, watching for the arrival of the tunnel boring machine from the center so much. Sunday cookouts and movies with Eva, being the auctioneer for community projects, Sharks baseball games with his grandkids, Port City beer, Marquette basketball, Nats and Caps games, Commanders, not so much. And life itself. He did enjoy every sandwich. I will miss him terribly, and so will all of you. There should have been more sandwiches.
together with all who died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Kerry in this life, for they are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever. In peace now, let us take our brother to his place of rest. Kerry, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham. And where Lazarus is born alone, may you find eternal rest. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. seen.
As Kerry would say on his voice recorded message, so long.